which did not exist the day that this story took place. I'm going to read to you. We were just a little woods by the Wildcat Creek, which didn't have a name probably back then. But 2,000 years ago, before we existed, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John. I don't think they had any idea what was about to occur in their lives. Come on, guys, come with me. Okay. They went up on a high mountain by themselves. And Jesus was transfigured among them, changed. His appearance changed. And his face shone like the sun. Can't look at the sun. His face shone like the sun. And his garments became white as light. And behold, Moses and Elijah appeared to them, talking with Jesus. I expect they were talking about, I think another version says they were talking about what was to happen in Jesus' life in the next few weeks. Him being taken and tried, crucified, and so on. Peter said to Jesus, "Lord, it's good for us to be here." Poor Peter, he didn't know what to say. What do you say? You see Jesus turning like the sun all of a sudden, Moses and Elijah. "We'll build three tabernacles here, one for you, one for Moses, one for Elijah." And while he was still speaking, a bright cloud overshadowed them. And behold, a voice out of the cloud said, "This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased. Listen to him." Disciples heard this, they fell down on their faces to the ground and were terrified. They heard the voice of God. My. Jesus came to them and he touched them and he said, "Get up. Do not be afraid." And lifting up their eyes, they saw no one except Jesus himself. As they were coming down from the mountain, Jesus said to them, "Tell the vision to no one until the Son of Man has risen from the dead." He told them plainly, don't tell them until you see the Son of Man risen from the dead. May the Lord transfigure us. Heavenly Father, tonight we pray for a change in who we are, a permanent change, that when people see us, they see the Shekinah glory, the light of you, O God, the glory of God, your weight and your presence upon us. The law came through Moses, but grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. Lord, bring that grace to us tonight, and may the glory of God be upon each one here. And may you shine in our lives, so that when we leave this place and people ask about the hope that is within us, Lord, may we be able to share about your glory in our lives, your love, your presence. So I pray that you might overshadow us tonight, and that you might change us so we might be like Jesus. That when we pray. Amen.
Would you all stand with me tonight? Well, I'm sitting, but you're going to be standing. They're going to be standing. We're here to praise the Lord. And there's nothing greater, there's no greater privilege than to be able to come together tonight and to praise Him and lift Him up and give Him the glory and the honor. But the God we serve today is still the same God He was in the days of old.
Thank you.
Jesus.
There's nothing but a fall. Let me ever.
glad you serve a risen Savior.
Yes.
I'm so glad I serve a risen Savior. Gave his life.
Yes.
He took my shame. And he gave me life in return. Beauty for ashes.
Thank you.
shows us as we give ourselves a living sacrifice tonight in Jesus' name.
Oh. Yeah. house tonight.
Yes, he is.
Yes, yes.
He has seen my awesome praise and worship, and he is inhabiting our praise and worship tonight.
Yes.
I've been given the task tonight in a limited time to challenge us to go to where God is leading us.
Amen.
As a citywide church.
Amen.
And I have wrestled tremendously with this in my heart and soul. There is a healthy tension that has been created in this city the last year.
Yeah.
Since God began to move and revive.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
But there is a dynamic and a tension that all of us are experiencing, and we're asking, what's next? And in the what next, we find that we are being intimidated, wondering how we're going to function together as a citywide church, and not lose our distinctive, our historical traditions that each of us in our denominations, our fellowships, our independent churches. At this level of revival, many of we leaders are considering the cost. Where do we go from here? I'm going to be as honest as I know how. I just celebrated 50 years walking with the Lord. But after these many years, my heart and the knowledge that I have of God's Word says there is more.
Yes.
Amen.
And there is greater.
Yes.
Amen.
I'm going to be brief and to the point. I'm going to give you, they said, share it from your heart.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm going to be a little academic for 7 points, and then I'm just going to let it go.
Yeah.
There's a pattern of historic revivals. When we study revival, we begin to see how God moves. And I believe that as we study, we can find how revival expresses itself. And when we begin to understand how revival expresses itself, we can critique the developments that we're experiencing in our city, our county, and our respective churches. We can look at the drama that's unfolding in this generation in which we live. Each phase of revival is a gift from God. Each phase intensifies and accelerates the work of God in revival. And each phase, if it's allowed to do so, will lead to a final experience of full orb revival. In our midst. And I believe these phases are very, very important, but I believe personally that we are in the first two phases. here presently. These are already in motion, and number one is realization. We realize tonight that revival comes to God's people when we are in desperate need of revival. And we understand tonight that we are in desperate need of revival. There's a growing expectation that God is ready to give it to us, to give so much more of Christ than we've yet experienced. We are about to experience it. The realization comes through both the preaching of many who see this vision and the convincing pressures of today's events in our society. We are being pressured by current events to seek God as we've never sought God. We are desperate for God to move in our society and our culture. And we're even more desperate for God to move in His church. We are in need of God to move. So we have this healthy realization. And then we are in a state of preparation. Christians begin to persistently pray and prepare for revival. We pray individually and corporately, and we're doing that all over our city, and thankfully so. We're beginning to have a growing consensus of what revival should look like, and that revival, when we really experience, is very neat. It's life-changing. It brings a radical element to we as believers. And we find ourselves selling out and saying yes to God in places and in things that we've never said yes to Him before. So we're prepared. Prayers are expressed in joyful anticipation, but also sober repentance.
Amen. That's right.
Amen.
There is a sobering repenting going on in His church today. Christians in times like this begin to commit ourselves to reorder our lives. And we're reordering our ministries to be ready to run for the full impact of revival. Amen. This is where we're at. We're getting ready to run. Yes. We're getting ready to reap the harvest. Yes. We're getting ready to change our city for the better. Yes. Our community for the better. And we don't have to apologize for being a believer.
Are getting out of religious mode into life mode.
God's people to offer ourselves in fresh new ways to be used of Him to extend the kingdom of Christ all around us. Revival is a time of recruitment. When God raises up and thrusts His laborers out into the harvest who are wholly devoted to Him, not only the local cause, but the global cause. Revitalization, preparation, manifestation, and revitalization. The church experiences renewal through the unleashing of the fruits of the Spirit. Renaissance through the unleashing of the gifts of the Spirit. And the ensuing renovation of the very programs and structures of the church to fit in with God's new way in His people. Let me create a little tension here, right now. We get a little anxious when we start talking about the renewal of unleashing the fruits of the Spirit. And there's a greater tension when we start talking about the unleashing of the gifts of the Spirit.
Yeah.
Let me just... I'm a pastor. Okay? I'm not evangelist, a prophet, teacher, or apostle right now. I'm a pastor in the city like you are. But we create tensions amongst each other that shouldn't be created.
Excellent.
We've built some walls that have kept us from reviving.
Amen.
We've said things about each other that we shouldn't have said about each other. And revival brings us to a place of repentance.
Yeah.
And it brings us to a place of loving each other.
Yeah.
And permitting each other to walk in their convictions as Holy Spirit deals with them. There comes a tolerance with our fellow brothers and sisters that makes the ground at the foot of the cross level. That thus then enhances us going into the harvest. Why is the fruit so sparse right now? Why is there a lack of people coming to Christ in our churches right now? Why is it that it seems to be so dry? I'll tell you why. We have attempted to do it through man-made ways. But God is calling us to cry out to Him and say, Holy Spirit, come. Let Him revitalize you. And we will become revitalized simply by saying, Holy Spirit, come.
Yes.
Don't look for an experience or a manifestation. Simply, Holy Spirit, come. There's power in that. There's freedom in that. We'll bring fresh anointing, fresh fire and fresh power into our lives as believers. Revitalization, penetration. The revived church begins to influence and impact the society in which it finds itself. I want us to understand tonight witness of God. There's a reformation of society in morality, righteousness, justice, and government. And it causes our society to become just because His church is just.
Amen.
We can penetrate our society.
Amen.
We can make change by being changed. Pastor Nicky, tell me with my 12 minutes or so. Number 7, expansion. The gospel is extended in many parts of the earth and among many peoples, for the kingdom has not yet come. And here in our city and our county, there are homes where the kingdom has not yet come.
That's right.
Revival will cause us to go where Christ has not been preached.
Amen.
And taught.
That's good.
I want to challenge you with this. Luke chapter 11, verse 13. If you then being evil know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask
Him? Thank you.
Here's what I'm sensing and discerning in our community. We need Holy Spirit. We need Him in us as never before. But I want to close with this challenge from the heart. Lance Morrow said, history is filled with regenerations, with new beginnings, as one era replaces another. But because regeneration is always cleansing, but usually dangerous. Revival, as much as we desire, as much as many of us are passionately pursuing, is dangerous.
That's right. Amen.
It requires that we all learn how to apply the first law of wing walking. There used to be guys that would walk and they would fly their planes close and they would go from one wing to another. It's dangerous. You have to be coordinated. You have to be prepared. And the law cautions every person that's a wing walker. Never let go of what you've got until you've got hold of something else. Holy Spirit was dealing with me this week. This was brought so powerful into my heart. Church of Kokomo, we know what we've got. We know where we are. But we must have Holy Spirit to step from where we are to where He wants us to stand.
Amen.
And don't you stand until you know where you're standing. And where you're stepping to is greater and more than what you're stepping from. In revival, we must be sincerely honest, yet cautious, but committed. Committed. 16 years ago, we began our flight into this 21st century. I want to tell you something. If I was stepping on an airplane, getting out on the wing, and had practiced and practiced and prepared to step onto another wing, I want to tell you something. Stepping from the tip of one wing to another, that would be a terrifying experience. And some of us in this room tonight are a little terrified of what's next. But don't be terrified. You said, Pastor Russell, why don't I have to be? We may experience some moments of suspension in midair between this move of God we're experiencing into the reality of maturing, genuine revival. But if we know in our hearts that we're moving in the right direction, His Holy Spirit will sustain us.
Amen.
And we'll be strengthened. And we'll be moving forward into things God desires for us. Yes, we're entering into, a national world revival. And it is going to present to us something fresh, something dependable to take hold of, something worth stepping onto. Would you remember these words tonight? Where we're going, and what we're stepping onto and into is worth it, if you'll simply say, Holy Spirit, come. Pastor Nicky, can I pray that I'm going to turn to you? Father, There is a spirit of willingness to serve in this room. The leaders have committed to coming together. The leaders are committed to revival. God, you just sent me by today to challenge us to take the next step and have such love for one another that we would be in awe of what you do and the results, the fruit that will remain until you come. In Jesus' name.
Looked at him as we had the conversation, and I said, Bob, I said, do you have a relationship with Jesus Christ? He said, well, when I was a young man and a boy, I was baptized in the Baptist church. I said, that's not what I asked you about. I asked you, do you have a relationship with Jesus Christ? He said, well, I don't think so. And I said, Bob, would you like to have one? And he said, yes, I would. And I took Bob by the hand and prayed through a sinner's prayer. We prayed there. When we got done, you should have seen him. He had peace all over him like you'd never seen. I'll tell you what, I just praise God. He received it. And I'll say this. Once we were done and we prayed together and praised the Lord and thanked him for what he'd done for Bob. And he looked at me and he said, you're out there in that new building, aren't you? And I said, yes, I am. He said, I'll be there Sunday. See, that's what happens when you change. You don't have to beg them to come. They'll come. Are you here? Are you listening to me? When transformation truly comes in a person's life, you don't have to ask them to come. They'll want to come. And that guy, he was there that Sunday morning. And he brought three of his family members with him. And he came and we prayed over him and he left that building excited and he was going after more. But you know what? Thursday he got saved. Sunday he was in church. The following Thursday he went home to be with the Lord. In 1 week. 1 week. But I see more in that week. God moved a seed planted and a neighbor. Amen. And I told the people at the funeral, I said, my neighbor became family. Yeah. That's what happens. Church, that's where we are. I mean, we never know what's going to happen from day to day. All we got to do is just be ready and be open and let the Holy Spirit direct us. Sometimes it's when we're not even prepared that things begin to happen. It's the unawareness of things, but you know what? Just let your light shine. Just be what Jesus wants you to be. And I'll tell you, he'll take care of the rest of it. Amen? He'll transform the lives. We just have to be that light out there in our community. Man, when I built that porch in my home on Kickapoo Drive, I've been praying for that whole neighborhood. That was in 1998. And I still believe God is working and he's doing things. He's going to continue. Amen. I know we're getting ready to close, but I just don't want anyone to be left out. If there's something you need in the Lord, then mind him. Just go before him and say, Lord, just take me. But most important is be like a prophet and say, Lord, just use me. Lord, just use me. Amen?
Amen?
Just use me, Lord. Just let me be that neighbor. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Praise God. It's amazing what God can do. Praise the Lord. Whatever your need is. Can we sing that chorus one more time? Amen. And if there's anyone here, just come and find your place to pray. Or take someone by the hand and let them come and pray with you. Whatever that is. Just find the Lord. We're here tonight. God is good. His presence is great. Message. When there are powerful message. Amen.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yes. Yes.
It's going to take a whole bunch of folks, and you go on and serve together at Kokomo, and there's a Buckman says, I'd like to join the team. I estimate we're going to need 250 volunteers on that weekend to pull it off. And you know what? God's going to supply them. I know that he is. But our brother said it tonight, man. But I so, I wonder, revive came, and it's so many things have happened in the last year, but one of the blessings is we've getting to know you. Amen. You are such a blessing to us. We don't do this in our own strength.
Amen.
We serve in his strength. So we depend on him, we pray, and I want us tonight, is this okay to end this way? I want us tonight to do this. I don't want you to stand. I want you to, if it's possible, in your seats. I want us to end this night where we're on our knees begging God to show us how to reflect him to this community when we walk out of this place. Would you do that tonight? Would you all get on your knees if you can, as much as you can physically, if not, stay in your seat, and just get before the Lord. Would you do that right now? On that Sunday evening, that the sound of praise together in an outdoor service would just go across this community. Would you pray for the power of those that hear the sounds of our praise? Would you pray right now? Heavenly Father, we don't call you that lightly. You told us to have, you said, if we be sometimes as evil fathers can still give good gifts to our kids, how much more will you? So we're calling you Father. We're saying, Abba Father to you. We're believing that you provide what we ask for and provide what we need because we're calling on you to provide to what you've called us to. So God, across this room right now, we're uniting our hearts in prayer. For June 11 and 12, serve together. Serve this community. Serve Jesus Christ. Serve together, God. And will you continue to break down the walls that so foolishly divide us, Lord? Will you take and cause us, as he said earlier, perhaps we repent of thoughts we've had or words we've said against other brothers. And God, may we, and sisters, and may we simply, in this time, lock arms and serve together where someone looks and they say, oh, what church are they from? And say, well, they're from this church and that church, but actually just one church, the Church of Jesus Christ in Howard County. Help that to happen. Help it to happen. God, provide the projects and the people and the individuals and the homes and the organizations that we're going to need to serve. And then God, provide the troops, the individuals that are going to take the details and the aspects of this to help provide the leadership and the structure and the administration for it. But then God, when we get to that weekend, God, we ask you, we beg you, help us to serve in a way that reflects Jesus Christ to this community. And God, we would love to have the city officials, the folks that go to work on a Monday morning saying, I don't know what happened this weekend, but there were just Christians all over the place showing your love and showing that love in this community. And I don't know, there was something different about them because they simply were doing it no strings attached, serving together. God, may that happen. May you give us a better reputation and image with those that sometimes look at us in the wrong way. God, help them to see our purity of our heart and our love as we do this very thing. And then God, I would even dare pray, as we gather together as believers and serve together, I would dare pray to make connections, make new friendships, new relationships. God, some of us, if we spend time with each other, we might find we like each other. God, help it to happen that weekend. Help it to happen to where we spend time together and you knit our hearts and iron sharpens iron. And the things that happen, God, I can't even name them all, but we ask for it to be true. And then we most of all ask that when we finish that weekend, that Jesus Christ has been glorified, and that people have been drawn to him. And like Brad's report, we would love to have reports of souls saved in the midst of a serving project. You're kneeling in front of somebody's house and helping work in their flower garden, and then they start talking to you, and pretty soon there's a different work going on. God, can that happen in that time? We would pray for that to be true. So Lord, we unite, that's what this service is called, we unite our hearts as we walk from this place, dependent on you and committed to following what you call us to do. Do this now and bless these folks for this time you spent. In Jesus' name, all God's people said,
Amen. Amen.